That's okay. Right. About your work, the violin concerto of Brahms arranged to piano concerto. I thought, was it pure love for this piece, or also, or just to enlarge the, you can say, the encyclopedia of the classical piano concerto?
You know, I was thinking about this very much. There are many reasons why I did this arrangement, subjective and objective. One of my first recordings I've ever heard was the Heifetz recording of this concerto. Okay. Mm-hmm. But I also think that in the 19th century, it was not a taboo to arrange a music of other composers, of your own music as well. I think that also important fact for me was that this concerto, this violin concerto, had its roots in both friendship and practicality. It was written for Joachim, mm-hmm. the dedicatee and good friend, not necessarily for violin, but for Joachim. And since Joachim was a violinist, it became a violin concerto, you know. And also, it is very important when one goes into the correspondence between Brahms and Joachim, one detects that it first appeared to be as a symphony. And then later, Brahms cut four movements into three movements. Then later, he integrated some parts of it into second piano concerto. And then later, it became a violin concerto. So knowing all this, I thought it might be really, out of artistic necessity, a good try. And without such commission, I went to this work and went deeper into this. So it became, as it is now, 6 years later.
6 years later?
Yes, it took 5-6 years, actually.
To arrange this whole concerto?
To arrange the whole concerto. Mm-hmm. The score hasn't been touched. And, you know, it is not a transcription. If one played this concerto on a flute, that would be a transcription. But one has to really put this score, to set this music as if Brahms would have written it for piano. And one has to write in Brahms style. So one integrates the violin part into a piano setting, so to speak.
Okay.
So, and that took quite a bit of time, a lot of decision making.
Yes, I think so too. But let's listen to two fragments. One, it's the violin concerto, it's the second movement, and after that, we do your version.
Okay.
Let's listen. Both give me tears, so it's all right, I think.
Thank you very much. You know, the biggest compliment for me was after the first rehearsal, when the concertmaster of Atlanta Symphony came mm-hmm. and said to me, well, this sounds as if it was a piano concerto. And this was the main goal. It was, as I said, artistic necessity. It was not a taboo to do these things in the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century. We know what Brahms thought of arrangements and transcriptions. He arranged many pieces of other composers, for instance, Bach, Chaconne for violin solo, Brahms arranged for piano left hand, Schoenberg arranged Brahms music, Brahms arranged his own music, transcribed many pieces. So it was in the spirit of a time, and I'm very grateful to my label. They were ready to release this world premiere, and also to Robert Spano, the conductor in Atlanta Symphony. We premiered it in Atlanta last October. And
was it hard to find an orchestra to do this? Or
it was, in a way, a very nice story. I was, as I said, I wrote this for my own heart, with no set commission. So I was warming up with some tunes, also this beginning of this second movement, before playing Beethoven Emperor Concerto with Atlanta Symphony. And Robert Spano was next door, and he came into my dressing room and said, what are you doing? What is this? So I'm playing Brahms' third piano concerto. And he himself is, you know, ambassador of not only new music, but also he finds interesting to program, you know, also interesting arrangements or variations on famous tunes. Yeah. So he's a really dedicated artist, and he's himself a composer and arranger and a great pianist, and not only a conductor. So he said immediately, please let us play together, you know, after the concert. So we went after the concert into the dressing room, and I played him through, and he immediately said, oh, we have to premiere it. Give me world premiere. Uh-huh. So it was really a wonderful thing for me to hear.
Okay, going back to the second movement.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're a pianist, you're a composer.
Yes, as well.
Okay, so you know the violin.
Yeah.
You knew the violin concerto by heart, I think, also the sound.
Yeah.
Now, play for me the entrance.
So we have this divine, eternal tune. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, the problem is a violin can vibrate. There is a sustained sound.
Yes.
But what are attributes piano has and violin doesn't have? We have pedal. We can use polyphony in a much expanded sense. We can do certain arpeggios. We can do certain things that violin cannot do. And of course, if you integrate this theme, this tune, into a piano setting of the late 19th century in a Brahms style, after a lot of work and experimenting, you come up
with... Sleepless nights or not?
Excuse me?
Sleepless nights.
Sleepless night as well, okay. But also dreams, you mm-hmm. know. So this was really something you take home, so to speak.
Okay.
You know? Uh-huh. And after a while, I came up with this. There is, you know, a way how Brahms would himself set this mm-hmm. tuning, this violin writing into mm-hmm. piano score.
I can hear that's typical Brahmsian, but show what chord is typical for...
What makes it Brahmsian? First
yes.
of all, use of rhythm. You know, mm-hmm. Especially in a third movement, beginning of third movement, I think if one hand has slower rhythm, like... The left hand very often is not only a counterpoint, we should know that Brahms comes from Bach, inspired by Bach mm-hmm. and Beethoven, and matter of fact, this was also great inspiration for myself, since Bach and Beethoven arranged their own violin concertos as piano concertos. So Beethoven's violin concerto is, matter of fact, sixth piano concerto.
Yeah.
So one can also play with this. One should go deeper into the score, see what other instruments are doing. That's also very important. So I know maybe this score better than some piano concerto score, definitely, because you spend so much time. So you come up with... has this alla ungherese feeling. It is the same key as the Rhapsody, B minor. So you use, in a way, same range, same chords that Brahms maybe used in his 118 piano pieces, or this Rhapsody that was actually written about the same time.
Now for us, but
yes.
First tell me, is there something else coming up?
Yes, there is Beethoven's fourth piano concerto coming up next with Australian Chamber Orchestra. We recorded it last winter mm-hmm. During the tour, a national tour
but
in Australia.
Arrangement?
Oh, in arrangement. I was talking next city. In arrangements, you know, I promised the world that this is actually the only romantic violin concerto that could stand this transcription, and I would definitely stand to it. But I'm working on my next project as a composer, so that will be original piano concerto.
Okay.